You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Political Science 101. My name is Brenda Riddick and I am your instructor for this class. And so today we're going to be talking about the presidency. And we have a lot to talk about relative to the presidency, presidencies of the past, and our current presidential administration. So as we do with every class session, I invite you to send me your comments, your thoughts, and you can do that by calling in to 1-800-339-1193. Or you can also send them on via the askdhtvlive@gmail.com. And as they come through, I will read them. You guys have done a wonderful job sending me your thoughts and your comments over the past lectures that we've had. And we've had some really good conversation about what you've shared. So I would just encourage you to do that again. Last week, we got a little bit of a slow start on getting some of those comments. So knowing that things are happening the way that they're happening in nanoseconds with the way that our world is revolving and what's going on in our nation, I would encourage you to start your questions and comments at the beginning of the broadcast so that I can get in as many as possible throughout the broadcast. All right, so just as we do with every session, I have video clips that we're going to take a look at. And when you view the video clips, look for interesting pieces that you want to make a comment on or ask questions about, and then you'll provide me those comments and questions after the video clip. But they're all relative to what it is that we're talking about in the chapter. And again, this week we're talking about the presidency. Last week we focused on Congress. The presidency and bureaucracy are outlined in your syllabus as being part of what our conversation is today. We'll touch very lightly on bureaucracy if we get a chance. But the focus today is going to be on the presidency. So I would encourage you to read the piece on bureaucracy so you're prepared for any questions that may come up on the exam, your midterm exam. All right, so let me get my materials ready for our class discussion. And I'm going to start off by talking about some of the things that are in the news today as we speak on this day, March the 6th, 2017, before we actually jump into the chapter. So what happened in, or what's happening today, what's going on right now, you probably have more of the instantaneous happening right this very moment information than I do. But I'm going to tell you what I checked on before I came into the class, and that is Snapchat. I know lots of you have Snapchat, and Snapchat's IPO went public last week. That was their initial public offering. That's what IPO stands for. And it came in with lots of people buying into the stock, and made the two individual, the co-founders, instant billionaires based on the volume of stocks that came through, which was a good day for the stock market, which is always a good day for anyone who invests in stocks, mutual funds, and bonds here in the U.S., which then trickles across the globe and makes it good for us in other countries, where countries are trading with us or depending on our wonderful positive economy. So, but today, it looks like there might be a little bit of a downward spiral as news has been released about some of the losses that have occurred with Snapchat over the last year or so, and how much debt is already existing on that particular stock, and people are selling off at below market numbers of what the stock ended with last week when it opened on its initial offering. So that's one piece of news. So the stock market might take a little bit of a dip today when it closes, or it's already closed, actually. So I don't know what the numbers are yet. I can probably look them up when we see one of the videos and tell you how we ended up. Because we've been, the stock market has been increasing since mid-January, and we've had one or two low days. Today might be one of those days that we can add to that low volume. Okay, so what else is happening? President Trump issued a new travel ban. So what's different about this travel ban than the previous one? Well, there's five differences that have occurred in this particular travel ban, one of them being that the ban actually is initiated and starts about 10 days from now, as opposed to what happened in January, where it was effective immediately. So there's going to be a 10-day window for everybody on each end of whoever needs to work it, implement it, educate it, be enforced about it, or be informed about it, and then enforce it. We'll have time to do so, whereas last time it was just instantaneous and it created a lot of chaos. This time there's going to be a 10-day window that will allow people to figure it out. One of the other differences is Iraq is excluded from the original list. It's an indefinite ban on the indefinite ban on Syrians has been lifted with this initiative that's coming forth to be implemented in 10 days. What does that mean? Well, for travelers, it's the ban is for 90 days, and for refugees, it's 120 days. Green card holders are not affected. There was some chaos and some interesting misunderstandings about what that meant in the first round when that was done in January. And then the fifth one is there are no religious preferences outlined in this particular order that President Trump has signed off on today. So we'll have to wait and see what happens and what if anything, gets moved forward to the courts about the changes or the modifications between this ban from the president and the one that was issued in January. And then the Housing and Urban Development Secretary, Ben Carson, who was approved and sworn in last week, has created somewhat of a firestorm now on the internet, on Twitter, and all kinds of social media mechanisms. As he referred to slaves as immigrants while speaking Monday to his department employees at HUD, which is Housing, Urban, and Development Agency in our federal government. And he likened slaves who were not immigrants being in the bowels of the slave ships, the ships that came across with slaves in them, that they were seeking the American dream, and that they were just like our mothers, grandmothers, aunts, uncles, nephews, nieces, you name it, family members, who wanted nothing more than to come to the U.S. to find the American dream and pursue their happiness. And that has an analogy to being a slave, being an immigrant, and how hard they worked and how many hours they worked, that has created another controversy in the current presidential administration that will need to be addressed. And then we have a day without women. A day without women. What does that mean? We had the Women's March back in January, on January 21st of this year, where women came out in droves across the United States and globally. And it was a day of unity and solidarity as far as women were concerned. And so now we're taking it from the march to an actual strike. So what will happen or what has been called for on this Wednesday, March the 8th, is women across America will actually strike. So a day without women, similar to a day without an immigrant or a day without a migrant, which happened a couple of weeks ago across the United States. So what are women asking for? What is the purpose of all of this? They're calling attention to the economic injustices women face with lower wages, gender discrimination, sexual harassment, and job insecurities. And so there's going to be more of a highlighting of those particular issues. The day is also intended to push for gender justice. So people who have been recognized who are trans or who are gender nonconforming, these individuals face equally compelling issues of discrimination and marginalization. So there will be a big focus on all of these areas on Wednesday. So we'll see what the turnout is, not just here in the United States, but from an international perspective. International Day of Women will also, anybody involved in that movement will also be participating. So those are just a few, I think it's five current events that I have for you before we start today on the presidency. There was one more. That President Trump tweeted on Saturday that former President Barack Obama had wiretapped his residence in the Trump Towers and his offices in the Trump Towers. And so we have another issue of chaos going on right now between the president, President Trump, and the former president, the White House, the Congress, congressional figures, the public, high-level officials within the White House. Yeah, so we haven't even gotten to the 100-day mark yet. I think we're at, day 40? Somewhere in there. So let's talk about the presidency. What is the presidency? Should the president represent the interests of the people who voted for him or all Americans? That's a great question, so I ask you guys that question. The presidential job description, according to our chapter, begins with discussing two different roles of the president, one being the head of government and one being the head of state. In the role of the head of state, it is a political role of the president as a leader of a political party and then an arbitrator who gets what resources are needed for everybody else. The head of state, on the other hand, is apolitical. It's a unifying role of the president as a symbolic representative of the entire nation, the entire country. Okay, so how did we get there? Well, Article 2 of the Constitution discusses the specific qualifications and conditions for the office. In a few minutes, we're going to see a clip on that. And then last week, I shared with you the qualifications for members to become to run for office and then become part of the House of Representatives or the Senate. Well, there is criteria for who could be president, who could run for the office of president. And we'll see that in just a few minutes. But first, I want you to watch this clip on memorializing the presidents. It's not very long, so take a look at it. Come back at me with your thoughts, and then we'll pick up more about the presidential job description as described in the text and as we know and understand it.
Memorizing presidents is gonna take some effort. Start with George Washington, Adams, and Thomas Jefferson. Then James Madison and James Monroe. John Quincy Adams like his father before. Next up, we got some interesting folks named Jackson, Van Buren, Harrison, Tyler, and Polk. The next four presidents that we'll examine are Taylor, Fillmore, Pierce, and Buchanan. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves. We got Johnson, Grant, and Rutherford Hayes. James Garfield, Chester Arthur, Cleveland, and Harrison. Let's keep going farther. Next up, we got Cleveland again. Then McKinley, Roosevelt, Taft, and Wilson. The next four, yeah, you know who they are. It's Harding, Coolidge, Hoover, and FDR. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. No presidents are from Wisconsin, not Truman, Eisenhower, Kennedy, and Johnson. We're getting near the end, it's not harder. It's Nixon, Ford, and Jimmy Carter. Last few, we're almost done. We got Reagan, Bush, Clinton, and Bush the son. Obama is in the White House now. So hail to the chief, stand up proud. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. 44 presidents, White House residents, from the Revolution to the age of the Internet. Internet.
Okay, so we need Kanye West, who was doing that memorialization. Memorializing of the presidents, we need him to update that particular one to include President Trump, and we'll maybe have that one out next year. All right, so getting back to the presidency, the job that this person has, the expectations of us as Americans for this individual. What we want to learn in this chapter is the double expectations gap between what Americans want the president to do and what the president can actually deliver in the time frame that he or she has. We're going to talk about the evolution of the American presidency from its constitutional origins to what we have today as a modern presidency. And we'll talk about the president's struggle for power as it has been challenged by different presidents over time. And we can see that today in our current presidential administration. The organization and functioning of the executive office, what are they for? What is the cabinet? What does that mean? Not the cabinet, kitchen cabinet, not the one in your actual kitchen, but what does it mean for the different offices that are upheld in the White House and what's their function? And then, of course, the role of presidential character. All right, so the gap, there's this double expectations gap that's talked about related to the presidency, and it's the gap between presidential promises and powers of the office. And so presidents campaign on promises that they would like to see happen for America, that they would like to have done and negotiated and worked and compromised between Congress and themselves, as far as the House, as far as the White House. But then there are issues that come about, and it's without fail that every president has their own set of issues. We also want to talk about unlimited promises versus limited ability to actually deliver what those promises are. This is part of the double expectations gap. We demand that candidates promise us everything during the campaign, but what do they really get to deliver? President's relatively limited formal powers prevent him from delivering on promises while in office. And so what that means is presidents are given an initial time frame, that they're a term that they're in office. It's 4 years, right? That's the typical time frame. That is the time frame, the term limit. What can they actually reasonably get done based on the promises that they make coming in the door and what's already in the pipeline that still needs to be worked out from the previous president, if there is anything in the pipeline that needs to be worked out? Pipeline is not always clean, so there's something that has to be worked through before the new president can actually affect any of his or her agenda. In the case of where we are today, President Trump has things in the pipeline left over from President Obama, but he's also enacting new things that he wants to do based on the promises that he made when he was running for office that he's been able to attempt to put into place immediately. The travel ban being one of those that we can look at that, the issue around immigration reform. Rolling back Obamacare or the Affordable Health Care Act is another one, although that might take a little bit longer, but putting the word out that that is something that is going to be addressed and taken up within the first 100 days. Not everything, though, gets to be done in the time frame that's allotted to that individual in those first 4 years because of whatever's in that pipeline that still needs to be worked on, and then whatever new is coming across, and then whatever relationships need to be developed between key players, i.e. Congress, both on the House and on the Senate, no matter who has the power. Okay? As we continue with understanding the double expectations gap, we also have to consider head of state versus head of government. And so I gave you a minute ago that part of the presidential role is that of head of state and head of government. Well, in the head of state, it's the apolitical unifying role of the president, and it's a symbolic representation of the whole country, of the whole nation. Okay, so that's head of state. Then we have head of government. The political role of the president as leader of a political party, and in this instance, we're talking about President Trump, who is the leader of the political party, which is the Republican Party, and chief arbiter of who gets what resources. And so looking at the speech to Congress last week, some of these issues about resources came up. We haven't heard the end of all of those as we look at entitlement programs, as we look at what might happen to entitlement programs. And when I say entitlement programs, I'm talking about Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and possibly welfare. Those kinds of decisions based on the budget and what the view is of the president for this country might look a little bit different than other past presidents and past presidents linked to their given party and what their parties are looking for. Okay, so as head of government, you also have to consider you must please the party, you have to broker deals, and you have to work to pass legislation. That's part of the job. That's what you have to do as president. That's not all you have to do, but those are big hitters when you're representing head of government in that role. Most nations like England separate these roles so that symbolic duties won't be contaminated by the influence of politics. They're able to separate them. We don't do that in the United States. We operate a little bit differently. So what is the evolution of the American presidency? Well, the framers' desire, it was their desire for a limited executive because they just had gotten rid of the king. They just came from England and, you know, embarked on this new territory called, eventually called the United States of America, and they didn't want a monarchy. They didn't want the kind of rule that they had just left. And so they created this kind of opportunity with limited executive powers. So who was going to do the rest? Well, we just talked about Congress last week, and we understand the role of Congress and how it works with the president, or how the president works with Congress. I think next week we talk about the court system, the judicial system, and how that links into each one of these pieces. But it was their desire, meaning the framers' desire, not to have the monarchy, not to have representation by the authority of a king figure. And so they had this limited executive that they put into place to represent the United States as it was growing to become a nation. All right, so let's take a look at the clip that talks about the evolution of the presidency. Come back at me with your thoughts. Langley has a comment, and I'll read his comment as soon as we come back from watching this clip.
Have you ever wondered who has the authority to make laws or punish people who break them? When we think of power in the United States, we usually think of the president, but he does not act alone. In fact, he is only one piece of the power puzzle, and for very good reason. When the American Revolution ended in 1783, the United States government was in a state of change. The Founding Fathers knew that they did not want to establish another country that was ruled by a king. So the discussions were centered on having a strong and fair national government that protected individual freedoms and did not abuse its power. When the new Constitution was adopted in 1787, the structure of the infant government of the United States called for three separate branches, each with their own powers, and a system of checks and balances. This would ensure that no one branch would ever become too powerful, because the other branches would always be able to check the power of the other two. These branches worked together to run the country and set guidelines for us all to live by. The legislative branch is described in Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution. Many people feel that the Founding Fathers put this branch in the document first because they thought it was the most important. The legislative branch is comprised of 100 U.S. senators and 435 members in the U.S. House of Representatives. This is better known as the U.S. Congress. Making laws is a primary function of the legislative branch, but it is also responsible for approving federal judges and justices, passing the national budget, and declaring war. Each state gets two senators and some number of representatives, depending on how many people live in that state. The executive branch is described in Article 2 of the Constitution. The leaders of this branch of government are the president and vice president, who are responsible for enforcing the laws that Congress sets forth. The president works closely with a group of advisors known as the cabinet. These appointed helpers assist the president in making important decisions within their area of expertise, such as defense, the treasury, and homeland security. The executive branch also appoints government officials, commands the armed forces, and meets with leaders of other nations. All that combined is a lot of work for a lot of people. In fact, the executive branch employs over 4 million people to get everything done. The third branch of the U.S. government is the judicial branch and is detailed in Article 3. This branch is comprised of all the courts in the land, from the federal district courts to the U.S. Supreme Court. These courts interpret our nation's laws and punish those who break them. The highest court, the Supreme Court, settles disputes among states, hears appeals from state and federal courts, and determines if federal laws are constitutional. There are 9 justices on the Supreme Court, and unlike any other job in our government, Supreme Court justices are appointed for life, or for as long as they want to stay. Our democracy depends on an informed citizenry, so it is our duty to know how it works and what authority each branch of government has over its citizens. Besides voting, chances are that sometime in your life you will be called upon to participate in your government, whether it is to serve on a jury, testify in court, or petition your congressperson to pass or defeat an idea for a law. By knowing the branches, who runs them, and how they work together, you can be involved, informed, and intelligent.
Okay, so that gave you insight into power, but also talked about how government is divided. And so that is a recurring theme that we need to understand relative to our institutions and the role and responsibility, not just of the president, but also of the legislative and the judicial side of the House. And when I say House, I don't mean House of Representatives. I mean the landscape, if you will, of those three particular branches. Okay, so Langley says the president should represent the interest of all Americans because in his perspective, his views, I believe it's not only his job, but could create less conflict between citizens. Thank you, Langley, for your comments. And many would agree with that. Erica says, do you think our government today has lived up to all the founding fathers wanted it to be? Oh, Erica, that's such a challenging question. I could say yes, I could say no, but I'm going to stick with maybe somewhere in between those two ends. Have we been able to do what it is that the founding fathers intended us to do as a country? We've seen some good times, we've seen some bad times, but then that's going to be in any kind of government, any kind of a situation, any kind of a power structure where you have leadership either autonomously or with a collective. So it could probably be said that we've lived up to a lot of what the founding fathers, the framers of the Constitution originally wanted for us as a country, and we could do so much more based on how the Constitution is interpreted to where we are today. As time has changed, there's been thought about tweaking the Constitution to conform to today, but then it changes tomorrow. Times will change tomorrow, times will change 5 years from now. Do we keep going back and tweaking it, or do we interpret it for the needs of the moment, the day, or for the long term? Alessandra says, would you say that in today's political atmosphere that the Republican Party and Democratic Party believe in the parties themselves first and often forget that the purpose of the parties is to represent the view or bigger picture for all people? I think many people would agree with you, Alessandra, that the two, and we talked about this last week with partisanship and hyper-partisanship, that we have seen quite a bit of the dynamics of the two parties so entrenched with their ideology that they forget who they're serving, they forget who took them and got them to the place that they are to be able to represent us as a body. And so I think sometimes they have forgotten exactly how they got there and what their roles and responsibilities are. Now, I can say that generally, but we know that there are also some great elected officials that are working on our behalf every single day, working very, very hard to accomplish what it is that their constituents expect them to do in whatever place they are within the government. So while we have some individuals within the Democratic and political party that are struggling to work for the greater whole of the individuals that got them there, I think most of them are doing the best that they can with what they have. Could they do better? Without a doubt, absolutely. All right, Wendy says, why do many people believe that the president can solve all the nation's problems in a click of a button? Are these realistic expectations, and why do we choose to believe in such a powerful presidency? Those are great questions, Wendy. And I think because people sometimes are not informed as they should be, educated on what the processes are, what the roles, responsibilities, what the power, what the limitations are of the individuals that we set forth when we vote, that lack of understanding then says, well, I put them in place to do the work, so let them go do it. They're going to take care of it. It's not my problem. Let them do it. Without understanding exactly what it is that they can do or cannot do. We believe that the president is the CEO, the chief executive officer of the United States, and that if it was a business, that person would have to make the business decisions, set the vision and set the mission for the organization to move forward and be successful. And that's how people view the office of the presidency, or many people view the office of the presidency, that person alone can make a world of difference. And in many cases, they can. But they also have to work with others to get it done. And I think that's where we have some, you know, issues. But that's our democratic process. Not every president is going to come in and have the cooperation for collaboration with members of both parties all the time. Okay. Let's pick up where we left off. Presidents have to wear multiple hats and attend numerous duties in their daily lives. So these are some of the things that we have seen change over time. Some observers argue that the president must wear too many hats, that they have to do too many things, which might be part of what Wendy was asking about, in order for them to do their job effectively. And then when the power of the presidents have seemed to have gotten out of hand or somehow, you know, we've lost control, Congress, the courts, and the media have been quick to limit it, showing how well the founder system of checks and balances actually function. And the clip that you guys saw just a few minutes ago talked about those different checks and balances. And I think I have another one that's coming up that's going to also reinforce the legislative process and ties into what the president can do from a veto standpoint, what the Congress then can do with the two-thirds majority vote to override the veto out of the House. But you'll get an idea that the president wears multiple hats. It's a tough job. It's not an easy job. It's a tough job. It requires a lot of patience. It requires a lot of intelligence, a lot of understanding, a lot of negotiation. You have to have people that you trust with you. You have to have, because you don't know everything. The individual does not know everything. So they have to have experts who can advise them on whatever it is that they need information on to be able to make good choices for the greater whole, which is us, we the people. So it's not an easy job, it's a tough job. How many of you would sign up to actually run for office? I think I asked you this last week. Running for any of the House of Representatives or the Senate in Congress, how many of you see that in your future, that you would be willing to do something like that, even at the local level? Would you be willing to step forward and put everything out there to seek the opportunity to help the public in some way or to serve the public in some way from an elected position? So what are these qualifications and conditions for the president? Who gets to do what to run for the office of president? I remember a couple years ago, Arnold Schwarzenegger, as he left his position as governor of the state of California, there was some talk about him possibly running for president. Is Arnold Schwarzenegger allowed to run for the office of president either then or now or in the future? So you guys answer that question for me. I know the answer. I just want to know if you know the answer. Qualifications. You might find it in this. Chosen by the Electoral College. This was modified by the 12th Amendment in the Constitution. Limited to 2 4-year terms in office. That was the 22nd Amendment. Must be a natural-born citizen and a resident in the United States for at least 14 years, and has to be at least 35 years old. Vice president succeeds in the event of death, disability, or resignation, and both of those were inserted into the 20th and the 25th Amendments. And also removal from office by House impeachment and Senate conviction for what's considered high crimes and misdemeanors. So those are qualifications and conditions for the office of presidency. Okay, constitutional powers. What powers does the president have? What can they do? Well, we already know that the president can execute executive orders. They can write executive orders, and then they can tell the rest of us what those executive orders mean. And they're enforceable, unless the courts get involved. Executive powers include, as chief administrator, the head of federal agencies. So the president is the actual head of these federal agencies that we have across the United States, but mostly founded in Washington, D.C. So head of federal agencies and responsible for the implementation of our national policy. They appoint cabinet members, which are heads of departments and agencies. We know that the president is the commander-in-chief, which means they're the top officer of the country's military establishment and the civilian head of American military forces, which is why when you see a president come off of an airplane or they're on a tarmac or they're in the presence of any of our military folks, there's always a salute. And so that is giving respect to that person who is considered the commander-in-chief of our military forces. And then, of course, they're the chief foreign policy maker. They negotiate treaties, make executive agreements with other countries. And so there's been this back and forth as the current president is learning the key players or key ally players across the globe and working out agreements with them that we're on the same page and in unison in helping each other. So that's one of their responsibilities as foreign policy gets made, that they are the chief foreign policy maker. All right, so head of cabinet and bureaucracies. Here we're talking about bureaucracies. We have bureaucracies for a couple of reasons. We have bureaucracy for a couple of reasons. If we didn't have rules, regulations, and order, we'd have chaos. And so the different agencies that are responsible for implementing policies have rules, regulations, and order that they follow, a process that they follow in order to make life easier for us or more challenging for us, depending on how you look at it and which end of the spectrum you're on when whatever policy it is gets implemented. Again, we have those situations in place so that we don't have chaos. Because if it was all up to us individually, we'd all have a different way of doing things. We'd all have a different way of approaching it, how we would want it, how we want to see it fulfilled, whatever the it is. We all have our own ideas on how that would look. But it's kind of chaotic if we're all coming at it from all kinds of different directions rather than some guidelines, some policies, some rules, some regulations that are put in place to protect us and to guide us lawfully. Okay, so as the head of cabinet and bureaucracies, the Constitution also specifies that the president, with the approval of the majority of the Senate, will appoint the heads of these departments who will oversee the work of implementation of whatever the policies are that have to be implemented that come out of the White House or that come out of Congress. Today, we have 15 cabinet departments and more than 500 federal agencies. Now, that's today. Tomorrow, next year, next week, next month, sometime in 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, those numbers may change. They may be lower. They may be higher. I doubt that they'll be higher, but they may very well be lower. So again, we have 15 cabinet departments, more than 500 federal agencies. We've heard that we heard from President Trump that he would like to eliminate some of these agencies, which means you would have fewer in the long run. Okay. One of them, I think, being Environmental Protection Agency, or at least changing some of the protections within the Environmental Protection Agency, the Department of Education, the IRS, Housing and Urban Development. A lot of these different agencies are going to be seeing changes over the next couple of years. And so again, those numbers may look very different from what they look like today. All right, on the horizon of legislative powers, let's talk about that for a minute. The State of the Union Address, which we didn't have one because the president is new, so we'll have one next January, unless he decides to have one between now and then. The State of the Union Address, this is a speech given by the president to a joint session of Congress and to the nation announcing the president's agenda. Now, the speech that was given last week to Congress, some are aligning that with the State of the Union. But again, the State of the Union happens the third week in January. This address to the joint Congress, joint members in Congress, was to Congress. Of course, it was televised, and yes, it was on the internet, and it was seen all over the world, but that one was specific to Congress. This, the State of the Union, is one for everybody, given in Congress, you know, in that building, but it's actually speaking to America, just as last week's did, so maybe that's a little different. Presidential veto. It's the president's authority to reject a bill passed by Congress. We talked a little bit about that last week when we talked about the powers that Congress has, may only be overridden again by a two-thirds majority of House members. And the veto threat often brings congressional compromise. So when a president says or determines or decides that they're going to possibly veto pending legislation, it opens a door of opportunity for members of Congress to go back and work with the president and the president to work with members of Congress to come up with a compromise that looks a little bit different than the piece of legislation that's sitting on that person's desk at the moment. So they try to work out something that the majority of the legislation can be passed. Just some minor tweaks have to happen in order for that to be a reality. Otherwise, two-thirds majority for the House will override the veto. Okay, So we have another video clip coming up, but I want you to, I want to go ahead and watch that, and then I'll come back and give some of the comments Joseph, Vaughn, and a few others have made. And then we'll get back into more about the legislative powers as it relates to executive orders. Very interesting things happening with executive orders since January the 25th. So we'll talk about that. So let's go ahead and take a look at this clip. This one is an overview of the legislative process so you can understand a little bit more about the legislative powers and the work between government, the work between the president and Congress relative to policy and legislation.
Article 1 of the U.S. Constitution grants all legislative powers to a bicameral Congress, a House of Representatives, and a Senate that are the result of a great compromise seeking to balance the effects of popular majorities with the interest of the states. Our system currently provides for a two-year term of office for House members from the 435 population-based districts. In the Senate, voters of each state elect two senators who serve six-year terms that overlap, such that only one-third of the chamber is up for election in any given election cycle. The two chambers are fundamentally equal in their legislative roles and functions. Only the House can originate revenue legislation, and only the Senate confirms presidential nominations and approves treaties. But the enactment of law always requires both chambers to separately agree to the same bill in the same form before presenting it to the president. Because each chamber has the constitutional authority to make its own rules, the House and Senate have developed some very different ways of processing legislation, perhaps partially flowing from their constitutional differences. In general, House rules and practices allow a numerical majority to process legislation relatively quickly. Senate rules and procedures, on the other hand, favor deliberation over quick action, as they provide significant procedural leverage to individual senators. Congressional action is typically planned and coordinated by party leaders in each chamber, who have been chosen by members of their own caucus or conference, that is, the group of members in a chamber who share a party affiliation. Majority party leaders in the House have important powers and prerogatives to effectively set the policy agenda and decide which proposals will receive floor consideration. In the Senate, the leader of the majority party is generally expected to propose items for consideration, but formal tools that allow a numerical majority to take action are few. Instead, majority party leaders typically must negotiate with minority party leaders, and often all senators, to effectively conduct Senate floor action. In both chambers, much of the policy expertise resides in the standing committees, panels of members from both parties that typically take the lead in developing and assessing legislation. Members typically serve on a small number of committees, often for many years, allowing them to become highly knowledgeable in certain policy areas. All committees are chaired by a member of the majority party, though chairs often work closely with the committee's ranking member, the most senior member of the minority party on the committee. In almost all cases, the ratio of majority party to minority party members on a committee roughly reflects the overall partisan ratio in the congressional chamber. Committee members and staff focus much of their time on drafting and considering legislative proposals, but committees engage in other activities as well. Once a law is enacted, Congress has the prerogative and responsibility to provide oversight of policy implementation, and its committees take the lead in this effort. Both chambers provide their committees with significant powers and latitude for oversight and investigations into questions of public policy and its effects. While the engine of legislative ideas and action is Congress itself, the president has influence in the legislative process as well. The president recommends an annual budget for federal agencies and often suggests legislation. perhaps more significantly, the power to veto legislation can affect the content of bills passed by Congress. Since it is quite unusual for law to be enacted over a presidential veto, Congress typically must accommodate the president's position on proposed policies. The process by which a bill becomes law is rarely predictable and can vary significantly from bill to bill. In fact, for many bills, the process will not follow the sequence of congressional stages that are often understood to make up the legislative process. The presentations on specific topics that follow present a more detailed look at each of the common stages through which a bill may move, but keep in mind that the complications and variations abound in practice.
Well, he was kind of boring, but we got through it, right? Okay, so let me read one or two comments and then I'm going to move on. Vaughn says, do you think that appointing members of both parties in cabinet positions would reduce polarization between the two parties? I do, Vaughn, and sometimes that does happen where a Republican president will appoint Democratic individuals to cabinet positions and vice versa. So should we kind of like have it balanced? I don't know that either party, the party in control, the members of the party in control would necessarily agree with that, but would it help to reduce polarization? Probably, yes. Lionel says or asks, can Congress censure the president for making a falsified claim? If so, does it carry any punitive weight or is it just a legal formality? Well, when you look at opportunities for impeachment or conditions that presidents have to abide by relative to the possibility of impeachment, it does carry weight. Something does happen in that process of investigation and then whatever happens, yes, the president can be censured for making a false claim. So we've got to see were there any false claims made recently that you know of in the last two or three presidential administrations that were investigated and looked at and found not to be true or to be valid and true? Erica says, do you think Trump will be able to completely eradicate Obamacare? Actually, Erica, I think President Trump has agreed to keep some pieces of the Affordable Health Care Act in place. And I believe that the Republicans have indicated this weekend that they may have a draft of a health care reform bill that they would like the president to take a look at. So I'm not quite sure just how much of the existing Affordable Health Care Act will go away, but I would hedge my bets to say that a large portion of it will. Does that mean that it'll be better for America or cause more difficulty or challenges? I don't know. I don't have any information, enough information to be able to give an opinion on that yet. Brianna says, I feel that this country's future is in jeopardy considering Trump has no political background. Trump has an economics degree from the University of Pennsylvania while Obama majored in political science with a specialty in international relations. Brianna, a lot of people are concerned and carry your same thought process along the lines of qualifications. And so I read the qualifications that individuals must have to be able to be president of the United States. And in there wasn't anything about education or there wasn't anything about education or knowledge about particular areas or fields or information. And again, that's part of why if you don't possess it, that's part of why you would have experts and advisors or experts acting as your advisors to help guide you with some direction on decision-making that you have to do, very powerful decision-making that you have to do for some very powerful decisions that have to be made. But yes, there are a lot of people that would agree with you on your assessment there. And then others who feel the opposite. Rocio says, why is it that there has not been a change to the law that the president can only be native-born citizen? Well, good question, Rocio. I don't know. Why don't you tell me why there hasn't been a change? You got me. So my question earlier was asking Arnold Schwarzenegger, if he could or could not run for the office of president of the United States, which was something that he had considered he wanted to do a few years ago. Well, you have to be born in the United States or natural born citizen of the United States. And Arnold Schwarzenegger was not born in this country. So he doesn't qualify according to the qualifications that I read to you guys a few minutes ago. He doesn't qualify. So he would not be able to do that. There was a push or a push underfoot to amend the Constitution to allow individuals who are not born in the United States to run for the office of president. And that never went any further than just a general conversation by people who were interested in having that possibility, but it didn't happen. It hasn't happened yet. All right, executive orders. We've seen a couple of executive orders come out of the current administration just in the last couple of weeks. And just for clarification on executive orders, it is clarification of congressional policy issued by the president and having the full force of the law. We talked about this a couple of weeks ago in some of the initial executive orders that President Trump issued in his first few days of office, including the travel ban. And it's the power to clarify how to execute law, but may fundamentally change the law. Historically responsible for major policy shifts, again, referring to our current environment, the travel ban, the immigration, the issues around immigration. Signing statements are a little bit different than executive orders. They're often confused with executive orders, but when the president signs legislation enacted by Congress, he may issue, or she in one day, may issue a written statement commenting on his actions. Some presidents have criticized the constitutional authority of Congress to make the law in question when issuing these signing statements. All right, so what are the judicial powers related to the constitutional powers of the president? Judicial powers, on the judicial side, there are judicial appointments that are made by the president. They can nominate judges to the federal courts. As we've seen in the first week, or the first few days of the Trump administration, he did nominate an individual who's going to be going through the confirmation process to replace one of our Supreme Court justices who passed away last year, and or year before last, in 2015. So the judicial powers, they're allowed to make judicial appointments, all right? They nominate judges to the federal courts and justices to, ultimately justices to the Supreme Court once they're confirmed through Congress. These are lifetime terms, and you have to have senatorial courtesy in those judicial appointments. And then, of course, we know that the presidents have pardoning power. They're allowed to pardon individuals who are in prison, whether it be for felonies or misdemeanors or whatever circumstances they're in there, and therefore they're allowed to do that. So pardoning power is a release or excuse, excusing a person from legal penalties of a crime. So once they're there, they can be released. And once they're in prison, they can be released based on a pardon by the president. And often it's controversial, and it's done usually at the end of the president's term in office. So when President Obama left office, he pardoned something like 220 people from different prisons throughout the nation for various crimes that had been committed or for injustices based on their being behind bars, and perhaps they were considered innocent but serving time. Solicitor General, and every president does that. Solicitor General is the Justice Department's officer who argues government's cases before the Supreme Court. Most cases heard and won more than any other litigant. Okay, and the presidents mostly conformed to the founders' limited administrative vision of the office until about the 1930s. Presidents expanded the office somewhat through inherent powers. So what are inherent powers? What does that mean? They're implied but not stated explicitly in the Constitution. So that's a little different. They're not stated explicitly in the Constitution. Those are considered inherent powers. This contrasts with the president's enumerated powers, which are spelled out in Article 2 of the U.S. Constitution. And I see that we have a call on the line. And who's calling? I knew it. Hey, Jordy, how are you?
I'm doing good. How are you doing?
I'm good. What's your caller? What's your comment or question today?
I had a question because you said that there was somebody being appointed into like the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And like, I just wanted to know like how long does that process usually take? And like, does it like matter who it is? Like, is there a different like process for each person? Is there like a set like process into confirming them?
It's a standard process for confirmation. They have to go through a vetting process, the background check, mm-hmm. and their family and their assets and all that is checked behind the scenes. And then they sit before Congress, members of Congress, and they ask them a lot of questions about their ideology, their philosophy, what it is that they have done in the past as far as laws that they've passed or supported. It could be anywhere from a few weeks to maybe a couple of months. They have to win the support. The individual has to win the support of members of Congress on both parties, the Republicans and the Democrats, in order to get through the confirmation process. But when the final vote is done, they may get through with only one party voting and the other party abstaining. As long as there's enough votes from that other party, they'll meet the confirmation. Sometimes the nominees have issues that come out while they're in the confirmation process. Things from a personal level that they did not share or explain before they got to the table in Congress, and they're dismissed as a result of that information coming out that may be too detrimental for them to hold the position of a judge.
Okay.
Thank you, Jordy, for your call. Did that answer your question?
Yes, it did. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Edward asked a question about the Electoral College, and let me see if I can touch on it today, but when we get into actual voting, campaigning, and elections, we'll touch more about the Electoral College. Edward says, do you think that the Electoral College in today's political climate is an inherently flawed system? Should we resort to using the popular vote and require a majority vote of 51%? Many people over the years, over the decades, have pushed an initiative here and there from time and again to amend the Constitution to eliminate the Electoral College and to go with the popular vote, like many other countries already do. We haven't gotten there yet. We have not made it to the floor with the vote to say that we should eliminate the Electoral College process and thus go with the popular vote and have elections go through that process and outcomes come out that way. So maybe this is the generation, you guys, that will affect that change and make that amendment happen. If you don't believe that the Electoral College is the right process, perhaps this generation will make that change. I don't know. So far, in all these decades, it hasn't happened. It's an institution into itself. It doesn't look like it's going anywhere anytime soon. All right, so where are we? The modern president. How has the modern president changed from what we call the traditional president? So the modern president era started in around the 1930s. That's when I said earlier that things had started to change as far as the inherent powers that the presidents assumed that were not explicitly written into the Constitution. And they lasted until about the 1970s, somewhere around the mid-70s. The federal government assumed responsibility for the economic well-being of citizens during the Depression. We know that that happened with Franklin Delano Roosevelt and the Great Depression. And what happened out of that was the New Deal. And then America's role in the world expanded over that period of time from the 1930s through the 1970s. We have been involved in a lot of conflicts. We've been involved in a lot of wars. We've been in wars where people don't agree that we should have been there to begin with, or conflicts where they don't agree that we should have been there to begin with, because our role in the world has expanded and changed, increased. Power and leadership responsibilities along those lines grew in the modern presidency. And then America's also started to have some very heightened expectations of what government should provide and not provide. So again, it goes back to one of the questions that you guys asked earlier. I don't know, maybe it was Erica or it was Wendy. One of you guys asked a question about why do we entrust so much power into the office of the president that this individual can solve all of our ills and solve all of the, take care of everybody for everything. We as Americans expect that that individual is going to do that. I mean, it might be a pie in the sky kind of an expectation, but we're looking for that person, that leadership, to take care of everything that needs to be taken care of for us. Is that unrealistic? Absolutely, it's unrealistic. With everything that's going on in the world and with everything that's going on in our nation, we can't expect that one person can do that. But we believe it, but that's the era of the modern president. Okay. There is a clip that I wanted you to see, State of the Union, January 2015. Actually, before we see that, let's go back real quick to presidential politics and the struggle for power. And what does it mean to go public? Along those lines, the expectations gap, which is the high public expectations but limited constitutional authority, means presidents really rely on informal powers. So they must have the power to persuade, which is the president's ability to convince Congress and other political actors, and of course us, the public, to cooperate with the administration's agenda. And so let's frame that today for what's happening right now with President Trump. President Trump has to use his power of persuasion to get Congress, the general public, us voters, constituents, allies, and then other political figures to buy into whatever his agenda is for this country so that he can be successful in trying to accomplish and check off each one of those things that when the 4 years that he's enacted to be president concludes or comes close to a close, that he can say he accomplished all these things. And in the state of the conversation, the speech that was given to Congress last week, he tried to share with the world some of the things that he was able to accomplish, that he has accomplished in the first couple of weeks of his presidency. But he has to use that power of persuasion when you have the partisanship, hyper-partisanship, polarization that we have in our country today, and then looking outside of our country, some of the world issues that are going on, he's got to be persuasive enough to get people to be on the same page as him to get anything done. Presidents use their presidential personality to persuade. All right? They use public presence to indirectly lobby other politicians. And then I ask a question, what does it mean to go public? Going public means the president's strategy appealing to the public on one issue or on a given issue and expecting that public pressure will be brought to bear on other political actors. And so if the president is looking to the American people with this particular issue that he has that he would like to have addressed or taken care of, we're listening as constituents. We're going to press on our local elected officials to follow the train, the trail, the path, the way that the President Trump is asking for us to have this piece of legislation, this policy, whatever it is that he's asking us to consider as a constituency, that we will bear pressure onto our elected officials to follow. So that's going public. All right. There is a clip that I wanted you to see. And this talks about, this is actually the State of the Union in January 2015. In working with Congress, what is the impact of a divided government? We've talked about some of the issues around a divided government. So take a look at this clip and come back at me with your thoughts.
Harry Reid is absent because he's still convalescing a little bit from the mishap in the gym, but I know he'll be back strong next week, and I've had a chance to talk to him. I want to thank the Speaker and Leader McConnell, as well as Dick Durbin filling in for Mr. Reid and Nancy Pelosi and all the leadership that are here today. First of all, some of these folks I haven't seen, so I've had an opportunity to wish them Happy New Year. To the Speaker, I just want to point out, I said there are going to be some things that we agree on. Having a college football playoff is clearly something that we can agree on. I called for it when I came into office. I think it turned out pretty well, particularly for Ohio, so I want to congratulate the Ohio State Buckeyes for their outstanding victory, and commend Oregon as well for fielding a great team because their quarterback is from my original home state of Hawaii. And I also want to just talk to all this leadership about how we can keep the progress going that we're seeing, particularly in our economy. The latest job report indicates that the recovery continues to move in a robust fashion. We've now created 58 straight months of private sector job growth, about 11 million jobs created in the private sector. Unemployment rates come down faster than any time in several decades. We now are seeing the strongest job growth overall, as well as in manufacturing since the 1990s. We are producing more energy than ever before. The deficit has been cut by two-thirds. And we're finally starting to see some movement last year in wages going up at a time when families are also enjoying some lower gas prices. So we're in a position to make sure that 2015 is an even stronger year. And relative to our competitors, we are holding much better cards. The key now is for us to work as a team to make sure that we build on this progress. Obviously, there are disagreements around the table on a whole range of issues, but there are also areas where we can agree, and that's where we're going to be focused. Just to cite a few examples, I've got a State of the Union next week. One of the things that we're going to be talking about is cybersecurity. With the Sony attacks that took place, with the Twitter account that was hacked by Islamist jihadist sympathizers yesterday, it just goes to show how much more work we need to do, both public and private sector, to strengthen our cybersecurity, to make sure that families' bank accounts are safe, to make sure that our public infrastructure is safe. I've talked to both the Speaker as well as Mitch McConnell about this, and I think we agree that this is an area where we can work hard together, get some legislation done, and make sure that we are much more effective in protecting the American people from these kinds of cyber attacks. I think that there's going to be opportunities for us to work together on trade. There's going to be opportunities for us to work together on simplifying the tax system and making sure everybody's paying their fair share. There are going to be opportunities for us to streamline government so it's more responsive. And on each of these issues, I'm going to be listening to everybody around this table, and I'm hopeful that with a spirit of cooperation and putting America first, we can be in a position where at the end of this year we'll be able to look back and say we're that much better off than we were when we started the year. So I just want to thank everybody for being here, and I'm very much looking forward to not just this discussion, but some real collaboration over the course of the next several months. All right? Thank you very much, everybody.
All right, so that was actually a conversation pre State of the Union address. And you had Senator Mitch McConnell and former Speaker of the House, John Boehner, back at that time. And the president, both of those individuals on each side of him were Republicans, and the president, of course, was Democrat. So you have to be able to work with members of Congress on equal footing and, again, compromise and collaborate to get done the people's work. All right, so let's quickly talk about the White House office. The people that work in the White House have a very close relationship with the president, and the president has to be able to trust that those individuals have his or her best interest at heart. So there is a close relationship to the president. The chief of staff is the person who oversees the operations of all White House staff and controls access to the president. So you can't get past that individual to the president without going through them first. Part of the managing the presidential establishment, you also have the role of the vice president. The vice president is very important to the structure of being inside the White House, being outside the White House, and standing in for the president from time to time. So the vice president used to be chosen to balance a ticket, had very little real power, but that has changed. Recent vice presidents have had significant roles in what they do in support of the president and the president's agenda and working with Congress. And then, of course, there's the role of the First Lady. And the First Lady has a range of roles. We don't know yet exactly what the current First Lady's position or role is going to be, but we've had, for instance, President Obama's wife, Michelle Obama, First Lady Obama from the past, was very concerned about children's health and eating and obesity and did her gardens out in the on the lawns of the White House. Laura Bush, very interested in issues of literacy, wanted to make sure that people could read who were not educated, that they had the opportunity to learn how to read. So that was very important. So different first ladies have different programs or agendas that they want to support for America, along with whatever the work is that their husbands are doing. At one point in time, when President Clinton was in office, Hillary Clinton, First Lady Hillary Clinton, was tagged to come up with a universal health care plan for America. And there was a lot of controversy and issues with members of Congress in allowing her to be able to do something like that. And so that initiative was ultimately killed. It did not go forward, and she was not permitted to create that universal health care plan during the Clinton administration. Nancy Reagan, First Lady Nancy Reagan, was forthright in the issue around drugs, and so we had the DARE program that was started in the elementary schools and high schools around just say no, just say no to drugs. So every First Lady has their particular agenda or their whatever it is, that their program that they want to focus on during the time that their spouse is in the office of president, in the White House. Okay, so managing the presidential establishment is really difficult. I said it's a tough job. It's a very tough job. So, difficulty, presidents have difficulty in choosing cabinet members, and we see some of that now with the challenges that President Trump is facing in trying to secure and line up the people that are going to support him in his particular cabinet. We've already lost one advisor, one cabinet member. Had to resign. We have issues and investigations going on with an existing cabinet member, Jeff Sessions, around the issues around Russia and talking to individuals before the election occurred in November, sometime during last year. So there are concerns. And the cabinet members are people who have key positions, key government positions in government departments, and they will ultimately be policymakers within the administration. So this chapter makes clear that presidents balance many political considerations when they actually start to build their cabinets. Sometimes it takes a few weeks, sometimes it takes a few months to actually put the right people in place. And again, you have confirmation hearings, you have concerns from the general public, you have the media weigh in, you have all kinds of influence into actually who gets to be part of the cabinet and who doesn't, who works out and who doesn't. Rather than just choosing cabinet members whose ideologies are similar to their own, presidents have to consider diversity and sometimes political payoffs in such nominations. So part of our discussion today is to talk about or to reinforce how the ideological differences often lead to discomfort between presidents and their cabinets as time goes on. Sometimes, and oftentimes actually, many cabinet members will resign and or they'll be pushed to resign, as in the case that we just saw with Michael Flynn. Between the president's first and second term, sometimes these things happen. And why presidents typically begin to focus policymaking within the executive office of the president. All right. So we talked about vice president and the president. We talked about the White House cabinet. Presidential character, James David Barber, classifies presidents on two dimensions. Number one, their energy level, passive or aggressive, passive or active, and their orientation toward life. Is it positive or is it negative? And then classifying presidential personality, what exactly does that mean? There's an expectation that knowing about presidential personalities will actually help explain or predict future presidential behavior. So is there anything that you guys can think of from a presidential personality that we've seen in our current administration or our past, former President Obama's past administration, that would explain or predict presidential behavior from either one of these two individuals based on their presidential personality. So share that with me if you have any. Presidential style, well, this is an image that's projected or portrayed by the president that represents how he would like to be perceived at home and, of course, abroad, globally. It's used by presidents to differentiate themselves from other presidents. So what made President George W. Bush different from President Bill Clinton, or George W. Bush different from President Obama, or President Trump different from George W. Bush or President Obama or President Reagan or President Eisenhower? What is their personality style? What is their presidential style? It's used by presidents for the public to perceive these different kinds of traits, for them to see the differences in them. Okay? Citizens check the president in what way? Well, we have public approval. Last week I gave you guys the approval ratings for Congress. We went over a period of 3 years. I trended back to 2015, 2016, and January 2017 using January figures for each one of those 3 years. Well, the president has an approval rating as well. Some presidents rate high, some rate low, and it changes over the time that they're in office. It could change from month to month. Depends on what's going on with the country at the time and what's going on in the White House and what's going on in Congress. It also could happen, be a matter of what's going on in the country as it relates to natural disasters. You had the issue with Hurricane Katrina a few years ago. Presidential approval ratings were waning at the time, and then they took a deep drop. You had, because of the reaction and the response that was either afforded or not afforded to people in the states that were hit really hard by Hurricane Katrina and the aftermath. That's just one instance where approval ratings were at one point and then they dipped, they went way down. Currently, we have a new administration in office and the approval ratings are said to be the lowest since, for many years, for a long time. Will that change? It might change over time, depending on what President Trump does through his next few years in office and the collaboration and cooperation that Congress gives to him. And of course, the American people holding everybody's feet to the fire to make sure things get done. All right. So what is it that I want you to see now? Well, this is inside the White House. So we've talked about the cabinet. We've talked about the vice president. We've talked about the first lady. And some of our expectations as citizens in keeping the president in check. So let's take a look real quick about what's going on inside the White House and then come back at me with your thoughts. Oh, okay, we're not ready, quite ready yet. So they'll let me know when we're ready. Going back to what we expect of the president, we have public approval is essential. It's important that we believe in and that we are aligned with the same or similar belief system, ideology, and agenda that the current president has for us, because that individual is working on our behalf. There is the possibility of reelection. There's influence of legislation going public. And then we want to make sure that from a public approval standpoint, whatever's going on, that there's an ability to combat the media and legislative criticism, that you can fight back against those forces that are not necessarily with you as president, but that you do it in a forthright manner, you do it legitimately, you do it ethically. All right, so I see that the video that I wanted you guys to watch is ready. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. This is inside the White House.
Fascinating. The Great Wall was very cool.
I was going to say.
One of the things I'm most proud of is the cabinet we've assembled. I mean, you've got extraordinarily talented people in each of these fields. A lot of them are doing such a good job that they don't meet with me much because they're like the good students in class.
they are just handling their business really well.
Well, hello everybody.
It is good to see you guys.
We try to do a cabinet meeting every 2 months. The meetings run about an hour and a half. What we'll do is talk to a lot of different folks within the White House, the policy folks, the Chief of Staff's office, the communications office, and find out what are the important initiatives that we want to talk to the cabinet about, and also talk to the cabinet as well about the issues that they think are important to discuss with the president. So there's a series of internal meetings to discuss that, and we hammer out an agenda after that.
Iraq, Afghanistan, eight major trip, jobs.
I think that there should probably be robust discussion of job creation.
Here, this is a huge kind of 6-7 weeks that's coming up, and a lot of the budget and obviously the war decision and a bunch of other things that are coming down the pike. So
each president has the discretion to decide who's in his cabinet. There are the heads of the 15 executive departments who are always in the cabinet. These are the people who are in the line of succession after the president and vice president. And then there are a number of folks who have cabinet rank. In our administration, that would be the head of OMB, EPA, the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, the U.S. Trade Representative, and the ambassador to the United Nations.
We haven't had coffee service in the past. Maybe because it's an afternoon meeting, they want to give them a little caffeine. I'm not sure.
I've worked for the president since he was in the U.S. Senate, so I'm very used to sitting behind him at meetings. But to now sit in a cabinet meeting in the historic cabinet room, you're just surrounded by the history of this institution. It's humbling.
Constitution was ratified and the government was established in 1789 under the new Constitution.
The first cabinet meeting, I understand, from 1793, the president had his four cabinet members there. We now have 25 people around.
Well, that concluded our video rather abruptly, but we're going to go ahead and pick up where we left off. I do want to share with you the few minutes that we have. Public evaluates each president differently. So Clinton's personal approval rating lower than the job approval. So from a personal standpoint versus a job standpoint, Bush's job approval closely matched, though lower than his personal approval. President Obama's approval rating directly tied to economic factors that were going on in the country. And the election will show citizens the ultimate check. So, as I struggle here with my paper, what is it that we need to understand as citizens? The American presidency was not meant to be insulated from the whims of the public, which is why the office is selected indirectly through the Electoral College. However, presidents still rely heavily on our public opinion and support of it, and ironically, often have a closer connection to the people than the institutions that represent them directly. So that's where I'm going to leave our conversation. I see that we have a couple of comments, and I'm going to go ahead and read those. And there is one more video that I want us to see. So let me read two of these comments. We'll go to that video, come back, and then we'll close out. Okay, so Kenneth says, working with members of Congress of the other party is essential to hear the viewpoints of the other party. Compromise can be made to help both sides that each person represents. It will help both representatives speak for the people on both sides. Couldn't agree with you more, Kenneth. Good point. Fabricio says, similar to World War II, when Congress passed a War Powers Act, which granted the president unprecedented authority over all aspects of the conduct of war, can similar power be given in times of peace? Wow, such a very long, convoluted question, Fabricio. Can similar power be given in times of peace? The War Powers Act, in times of peace, for what? You mean to go to war? President can't just declare war. They have to go through Congress to get authority for war to happen or to engage in a war. A conflict, yes, they can do a conflict for up to 6 weeks. But to engage in war during peacetime, then I'm not really sure I understand your question, Fabrizio. Amir says, do you feel that the Electoral College is a wrong way to determine who is president? And if so, do you have any ideas on how we, the people of the Congress, can fix it? This question came from the outcome of this election. Thank you, Amir, for your question. Again, I think it goes back to the Electoral College was the institution set forth during the time that the framers created the Constitution. It does not necessarily meet today's current environment, current political environment, or the population that we have, or the diversity, or the dynamics of America. But it is one of those institutions that has been able to sustain itself over time. Should we move away from it and use the popular vote? I think many people would agree that it probably should do that, Amir. But we haven't yet. So what suggestions? All I can say is for this generation to go back and look at what the ideals of the framers were relative to why the Electoral College was used and is used in the manner that it is to elect the president, and figure out how to change it if it's to be changed, or make it better if it's to be made better. All right, I'm not quite sure if, I'll ask the back room here. Do I have time for another video? No. No more time for another video. All right, so I am going to close on that, and I would encourage you guys to study those chapters leading up to, where are we? The federal court system, which we will cover next week, and then I'll talk about your midterm exam after our broadcast, towards the end of our broadcast that we have next week. And it will include all up to and including the federal court system, the judicial court system, not just the federal, but the judicial court system. All right. On that note, have a great week, and I will see you guys next week. Thank you.